Tell us a bit about your formative years as a musician. Like, what did you grow up listening to? Did you come from a musical family? Was there a person that affected you or mentored you when you were younger?
Growing up, my dad taught me to play guitar. My dad played music, and I grew up in a little town in Texas, East Texas, and so my dad had a little band, and they played country music, and it was really all about the Outlaws. It was about Willie Nelson, about Merle Haggard, about Johnny Cash, that's what my dad listened to. He loved that music. And so when he put a guitar in my hand, I was like 9 years old, and he started teaching me to play a lot of Willie Nelson songs and Merle Haggard songs and that kind of stuff. And that's kind of where it started for me. I loved learning. I would just, I would try to learn whatever dad would teach me in the morning. I would learn during the day. He'd come home at night after work, have to teach me something else. I just work at it and work at it. And so I really, even from a young kid, I loved it. And growing up in the church and being part of the church as well, my parents were very involved in our church. And so they would, I just started learning the music of the church and started playing as I got a little older, playing in my youth group and things like that. I started doing that. But yeah, it's kind of funny. My first influences was that early kind of 70s country kind of stuff, which my dad loved.
All right. When did you start writing music?
Yeah, I was probably, I attempted to write songs when I was in high school. They were they were terrible. But that was really bad. But I think I got really serious about it right out of high school into college. And started developing it was this interesting thing because I had this real heart for writing songs that what I would just say is people could sing. I didn't really know what a worship music was. Didn't know the term worship music or worship leader. Even as a young kid, I would play at my church and I'd try to find songs that would people would love to sing. Even if I played on Sunday, I just wanted people to sing along. And I realized now that God was putting this kind of gift in me, long before I knew even what it was, to write songs of worship, to write songs of praise to God, and very congregational. And so that's when I got out of high school, I started trying to write songs that way, very simple songs that people could sing. And that was as honestly as pure as it was. It wasn't like, I want to do this genre, this is my goal. It was just like, I was just, for my Bible study that I was involved in college, I was trying to write songs for that, and they start, all of a sudden, I'm in college, and these songs just really start finding their way into other churches, start playing them, people start hearing about them, and that's kind of the first steps.
So when you write a song, does the melody or does the lyric come first, or what's the process?
Yeah, usually starts with the lyric for me, and then sometimes it's... But most of the time it's together, which is odd. I find that there's something I want to sing about, whether it pops off of scripture or it pops, I hear something that's said in a message at church. I thought, oh man, that would be really good to sing that, or some kind of little piece. And I begin to just kind of sing the idea out. So it kind of comes together a lot.
Now I have to ask you about this, and you probably know I'm going to ask you. How great is our God?
Okay. Yeah.
Now, where were you exactly when that popped in your head?
I was in Austin, Texas. I was living there, and I was in my house apartment, and I can remember sitting on the sofa like it was yesterday, and just kind of strumming my guitar.
What was the first chord?
C chord.
It was a C chord.
Oh yeah, and I was just strumming my guitar, just kind of playing C. And I started singing that little chorus. I mean, it just kind of came to me, the chorus. And it was so simple. I mean, there wasn't much to it. And I thought, okay, there's nothing but, that's nice, but I don't know exactly how, if this is anything. But it was just a little simple, how great is our God. That's all it was that chorus.
Just the chorus.
And I had a different verse. And and it's interesting, I was writing the song with my bass player at the time named Jesse Reeves. And he had this, we had worked on this verse idea and some verse thoughts on it.
Yeah.
And that kind of, I think after, that kind of inspired the chorus for me. Then the chorus, I just played the chorus and then we scrapped the verse. I had nothing. The verses you hear were not
Not the verses.
No, not the verses that we started with. And I knew it wasn't right, and so the song kind of progressed along.
How long was that process? The song that we sing now.
Yeah.
To that. The time from the sofa.
Yeah.
To the, you're on stage like.
Man, that's it was probably a good. I would say 9 months to a year, and it's really cool because I knew the chorus was something. I didn't think it was what it has become, but I thought it was something that people could sing and easy to sing,
yeah.
and very simple. But I started looking at the scripture, Psalm 102,
yes.
Or Psalm 104, and it's like, "You, O Lord, are very great. You are clothed in splendor and majesty. You wrap yourself in light as a garment," and all those. So the splendor of a king, clothed in majesty. You know, you wrap yourself in light, and darkness tries to hide. All came from that psalm. And so I'm just reading that along, and those verses start coming, and so the song now they have two verses in the chorus. It all feels great, and I'm like, let's go record it. And they introduced me to this guy named Ed Cash, who's going to produce my records, and that was the first time that we had met. And I played, that was the first song I played him.
Right.
And he's like, "That's pretty good." I mean, he wasn't very impressed. I was like,
he wasn't impressed.
No. He was like, "Well, it's a nice song," but I didn't, you know, wasn't like, I thought it was great. And he's like, "You know, I think it needs something else." And I'm just like, "What?" I mean, I've been working on the song for a while. It's got the verses, it's got the choruses. And I remember, I've first meeting of this guy, I remember he's sitting like this and he has his guitars on the wall. He picks his guitar up and he just says, "What about something like, 'Cause you're the name above all names, you are where?'" And I'm just like, I'm just sitting like where you are, and it's like, "Oh my God, who are you?" And like, that is perfect for this song.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that became our relationship, started forming out of that song.
Yeah.
And then obviously the song became one, you know, that's probably the coolest part, the best part of the song, and Ed brought. So. Pretty neat.
That is awesome. And what do you think your greatest achievement musically has been up to now?
That is a very easy question, because we've gotten lots of awards, you know. We've gotten lots of accolades, from Gospel Music Awards to Grammys to Billboard Awards to, you know, I've kind of received awards in every category.
Yeah.
And that doesn't even get close to comparing to me to how the songs have found their way into the church and how they... It really, because that is like, that's something that I'm proud of and very humble, because that's God doing in a special way. Nobody voted on that, really. It's just the Spirit of God saying, "I'm touching this song," and I'm,
wow.
You know, and that, how a song like "How Great Is Our God," or several others, how they can find their way into remote places in this world that. They're not tuned up to YouTube and what's the latest. They're not looking at what's the latest songs.
They're singing
these songs. That is God's Spirit to me,
yes.
blowing a kind of wind onto the songs. And so that's what I'm most proud of, because I feel like there's legacy there that long past me. And I always say this, and what I think is cool about it is that means that to me, when a song has done that, it's gone past me as an artist. It's no longer attached to me anymore. That's just the people's song. You know, just like the song Amazing Grace. I mean, that I haven't written anything close to that, but that's the people's song. It's not, no one thinks, "Oh, that's a John Newton song." When they're singing it, they think, "Oh, that's a..." So, like in "How Great Is Our God," most of the people who sing that would not know who I am, would not have a clue, wouldn't care. And I think that's really cool, because that's like gone into the fabric of people and the church, and so that's what I'm most proud of.
You've got a great appreciation and desire to help children around the world.
Mm.
I'm quite moved what you do. Could you share
a little bit about that? Yeah, I love the opportunity to help kids. My wife and I joined this group called Cure.
Yes.
And we sit on the board of Cure.
Yeah.
And I love it, because they have husbands and wives do it together. And I feel so unworthy to sit on this board. I mean, it's just, I've never been on a board of directors of anything before. And this being my first one is, you know, you're jumping the deep end, because it's like incredible people. Like, I mean, incredibly brilliant minds, Harvard neurosurgeons. And like, you're just like, "Oh, geez,
wow.
You know, what am I doing? This little musician here." And I remember sitting in the very first board meeting, and they're talking about all their goals and what what they're doing all over the world and healing kids who have these disabilities that with simple surgeries, their lives can be changed, their lives can be saved. And they're, you know, kids who can't walk, kids who've never been able to walk because their legs are deformed. These doctors heal them and do surgeries and these kids can walk, they can run. Kids who've been so embarrassed by their face because they were born with deformities. These doctors that have this amazing technology can go in, but to these places that have never had that opportunity in nations that would never have the kind of medicine we have in the United States or in Canada, they would, you know, they can go in and help these kids for free. And it's a beautiful thing. And so they were sitting in the first board meeting and I'm like, what can I do here? And they're talking about the need for people to know about this. And I'm like, I know how I can help. Cause I mean, I have a captive audience every night. I can talk about this and help people understand what's going on. And so it's been a huge thing for me to be able to do. And I have two kids myself, two girls, and 4 years old, 18 months old. And to know what a parent, just to feel a little bit of what a parent would go through, you know, knowing that their child, that, you know, and knowing that they, there's no way they could help their child if they needed to, just is heartbreaking. So it's like a place, a thing like CURE, an organization like CURE, they do amazing things.
Speaking about your daughters.
Yes.
How do you balance the tours and being away from home?
Right.
How do you do it?
I'm trying to find the right balance and do well at that. I mean, for instance, this Canada tour, you know, I try not to be gone more than 4 days before I fly back home and then fly back and then come back. And so, you know, it makes it more expensive. It makes it, but it's, you know, worth it because you're with your family. So, yeah, it's a new day for me. I mean, for most of my life, most of my touring life, I've just been cruising around doing my thing. And now, you know, being a dad and being needing to be there is important. So, you know, I don't know if there's ever a really good balance in what I do in this life, or I just need to go sell homes if I'm going to find a good balance, I guess. But, you know, there's no...
House concerts.
Yeah, right. Yeah, there's no really great balance, but I do the very best I can to do that. And my wife's amazing, and she has a great understanding of...
Sure.
Kind of knew what she was walking into, but has a great understanding of it.
Yeah. I got a couple fun questions for you.
Okay.
If you had... a choice of a superhero power, what would it be?
Oh my goodness. That's great. I think I wish
you could have two.
I mean, that's pretty simple for me.
Okay.
It's like it's either I want to fly because I'd rather just go boom and I'm there. Because travel really bothers me. I don't ever want to go through TSA again.
Right.
I don't want to get on like airlines again. I just want to go, okay, my concert is in Calgary.
Yeah.
I'm in Calgary.
Okay.
That would give me more balance. Then I could say, now I'm home.
I'm home. I'm in the house. I'm with my kids, right?
That would be amazing.
Yeah. When you're growing up and you're playing music, was there a place that, you know, sometimes you kind of dream that you could go play and then you actually got to go play?
Yeah, there's a couple of those. Two that come to mind, Red Rocks in Denver and Colorado. That's outside of Denver, it's just a beautiful, beautiful natural amphitheater.
Yeah.
Just really made by God, really.
Yeah.
It's just so gorgeous. And got to played that on my birthday a few years ago. Really special. I love that. And Madison Square Garden, it's kind of, you know, the iconic, famous place to play music, concerts in America. And we did that last summer, and it was really, really cool. So we got to play a lot of great places. That's definitely two.
Yeah. Is there a place that you would like to play that you haven't actually gone?
I haven't actually played?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Or a country. Like
there's certain,
like,
you know, for me, when I think about that, I think of, it wouldn't be what you would expect. I think it would be some of these, I love the mountains. So if I could, like, Telluride has this music festival. Aspen has this music festival. Maybe Banff has a music festival. I don't know. But like those kind of places, I love those little mountain towns that I've never gotten to play much of those. And so that would be cool because that's kind of my spot. If I could be anywhere in the world, I'd want to be up in the mountains. So
thank you so much for your time, Chris.
Yeah.
Love you.
Thank you, buddy.
You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are.